What do you call two guys that were there when this happened?
Back to return at Spurlock. Michael Spurlock at the 10. He's to the 20. He's to the 25. Spurlock 30 to the 40-yard line. We could see history. 50, 40 to the 30-yard line. No. Run, Michael. Run, Michael. Run, Michael. Run. Touchdown, Tampa Bay. There you go.
And that.
Shotgun set. Three receivers left. Here's the snap, and the blitzer is picked up. Brady underneath. Caught ball. Evans. He has the record at the 11-yard line. Mike Evans becomes the first NFL player in league history to record 1,000 yards or more in his first seven seasons, and what a throw by Brady. Congratulations, Mike Evans.
Who can forget?
Gannon looking again. Throws up the middle. That's intercepted at the 30. Derrick Brooks, 30. Touchdown, Tampa Bay. Derrick Brooks, the most valuable player in the National Football League. There it is. The dagger's in. We're going to win the Super Bowl.
Here's the snap. Mahomes running to his right. Look out. He may run. Mahomes directly. Oh, toward the end down. Battle. Intercepted. Picked off at the end zone. Bucs are going to beat the Chiefs. We're the champions of the world, and we still have a minute 33 to go. Devin White. What a great second season. That's it for KC. Bucs are the Super Bowl champs. They can't stop the clock.
We call them the Salty Dogs.
Welcome, everybody, to a very special episode of the Salty Dogs podcast. We did this for the first time last year, and we decided to do it again because it was a lot of fun. We are bringing
questionable about
right,
fun.
Okay, so let us introduce who's here first. The Salty Dogs. I'm Scott Smith.
And I'm Jeff Ryan.
And we're the Salty Dogs.
We are.
And we have with us our colleagues, Brianna Dix and Casey Phil.
Pause.
Had to think of it.
Well, your close
Casey
personal,
got married.
Former, your yes. close personal friend.
Yeah. Casey got married. Okay,
I knew exactly what was happening. No worries, everyone.
I paused for a second thinking, okay, which, yes, still Casey Phil.
Kept the work name, but just wanted to confuse you a little bit. I could see why the pause happened. It was like, yep, I have the same thing happen to me when I go places, which makes me look really stupid, like I don't know my own last name, but I'm having that moment of like, have I changed it here? I don't know.
Yes. So what we're doing here is we brought the four of us together to do a mock draft. Since the draft is this week, Jeff currently has his hand on his forehead
okay.
in desperation. He is doing this podcast in protest.
Basically, I am just working the equipment because I actually have a on and off switch on my microphone.
Yeah, well, feel free to turn it off.
Yeah. Your wish is my command.
Jeff likes mock drafts about as much as he likes talking about fantasy football. So
true.
That gives you any idea.
Right.
And so we are going to run a mock draft, but we have one question that I wanted to start with because it's relevant right now from our friend Alexander in Brazil. He says, ahoy, salty ones. Hope this finds you both well. Mock drafts seem to me a topic that Mr. Ryan does not love. So if he had the power to rule mock drafts, what would he do? Ban them? Limit to one mock a person? Limit to the week before the draft?
I would say that you're allowed to do one mock draft. If you're not correct, then you never, ever get to do a mock draft again.
What counts as correct?
Getting all the picks. How many picks?
Getting the picks right.
All 32 of them?
There you go.
No, you got to have there's got to be a bar.
Okay.
How many would you have to get right?
All right.
Over under.
You can't get the top five right.
Okay, you got to get the top five right?
In order.
Yeah, I get it. To the exact teams?
To the exact teams.
So you got to predict the trades exactly.
Exactly.
Good luck.
So 5 years from now, there just would be no mock drafts.
I know. Yeah. I understand people love this stuff. They, you know, it's fun to talk
That's
about.
That's why we're doing it.
But one of the things that I have to clarify is I do enjoy the draft
yeah.
on draft day when it's actually happening because mm-hmm. now that's called, I don't know, real life.
So you've never liked made a prediction about anything in your life. You're just anti-prediction.
Well, not about that. About the draft, I'm anti-prediction.
I
yes,
mean, like,
because you don't know. It's fun. You're speculating. It's like, oh, wow, you know, you might as well be doing astrology. You know, oh, yeah.
Astrology.
I feel like Jeff is, unfortunately.
That's a great point. Yes.
Well, unfortunately, no, I feel like he's trying to get rid of all of our jobs because essentially this is everything being a sports reporter yeah. is it, at this point, is
okay,
talking about what might
yes,
happen.
Yes.
And in fairness, I'm not saying you can't do it. It's just not my cup of tea.
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
Well, you just tried to ban them, so.
Well, no, the question was, what would I do?
Yeah,
how
no.
would I do it?
He
so
would ban them in a very subterfuge-y yes. way.
Making
well,
the
would,
actual.
He would make everybody very nervous, like, I got to get the first five, or
yes.
right. I'm going to get fired.
Then you'd really do your job, rather than just willy-nilly in.
Trying to predict what teams will do, all of that, all subjective. But I will say I really enjoy studying the players, learning about them. And then that carries over into the season. Because regardless if we pick someone or not, you're probably going to face a vast majority of them.
Yeah.
Okay. Let me
and then you already have that background knowledge.
All right. Let me ask this question. Do you know, when do you decide that you got a good pick? When is it that you can confirm
Isn't
that?
Isn't it three years in is what they typically say? 3 years?
3 years. It got to wait at least 3 years.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I mean, we can say now Tristan Wirfs was a great pick.
Right. Because
Antoine Winfield was a great pick.
Yeah. Now, because everyone talks about, you know, you got to get a first rounder. You know, it's so key. You know, you're stacking your odds there. But if you really do the math, and you always do, Scott, I mean, how many first round picks?
About 50%.
Okay.
It's a flip of the coin.
Yes. Yeah. So that's why.
But what this is and what we're going to do today, there's two different ways to do a mock draft. Well, there's many, but the two main ones are a predictive mock, which is what we're doing now, where we're trying to guess what's actually going to happen. Or you do a mock where you think you pick what you think the team should do. We're doing a predictive mock.
Yeah.
Okay.
Fair enough.
Well, this could take a while.
Which means we're not allowed to
started.
Do one next year because of JR's rules. This will be.
Well, we got to hit the first five. That's all.
Listen, this is for entertainment purposes only. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so Jeff and I were responsible for picking the odd-numbered picks.
I didn't know that.
And I didn't get a whole lot of input from Jeff.
That gives that away, JR. Jeez.
Bree and Casey do the odd picks. We do allow trades. We took care of the draft beforehand so this would go more quickly and smoothly. And we did allow mock trades, and we had two of them, which we'll get to when we get to them. Is everybody good?
We're ready. Let's do it.
I'm confused. Go ahead.
Chicago Bears on the clock. Ryan Poles, general manager. This one's easy, obviously. Caleb Williams, the quarterback from USC. I don't think we really need to go that much into that one.
Yeah. It seems to be the consensus on pretty much every mock is, and the only thing that I feel like is kind of the same amongst all of them is Caleb Williams at number one.
There's no doubt they're taking Caleb Williams.
I just wanted to say something I think is so interesting whenever I read these different bios and I look at all these players is the difference in the players that have been, they played a lot of different sports, or they very early on honed in on one thing, and did they seem trained for this? Like the different philosophies we all have about how we train kids in sports. Do we let them just play different things? Do we try to get them ready? Okay. Caleb Williams is fascinating to me that I read about how at age 10, he and his father created the plan. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, this is wild. It's in this training regimen, gets him on the path. Like, he's already got his own foundation. It was sports psychologists. It was diets and 5:30 a.m. workouts. Like, even as a kid, I'm like, man, I really hope it works out because that sounds brutal.
Didn't someone do that and a guy got drafted by the Green Bay Packers and then tanked? Do you remember that, Scott?
I think you're talking about Todd Marinovich.
There you go.
I don't think it was it the Packers? This was another guy.
Yeah, I believe he went to the Packers.
This is another guy.
That started out as a child and all of this.
Famously.
Yes. Had to do this, that.
And what happened was he burned out. No, he was drafted by the Raiders.
Oh, who did he go to? The Raiders?
The Raiders.
Okay.
He played two seasons.
I don't think it was quite that early, but didn't Christian McCaffrey have a similar?
I don't know. His dad was an NFL wide receiver.
Right. I feel like him and his dad at like a very early age started the conditioning, the diet, all of that.
I think Marinovich was more extreme. Like they wouldn't let him eat fast food his whole life. And so when he started to rebel a little bit and do some of the things he wasn't supposed to do, he kind of went off the cliff. It was too much.
Right.
It's a legitimate concern, but not enough to make the Bears not take Caleb number one.
Yeah, but I just think it's a really interesting strategy. And, I mean, maybe it helps in terms of he has been under pressure for so long that he's had this singular focus. So when you talk about that number one overall pick, maybe that sets him up for, you know, more success at that spot. I just think it's going to be interesting to watch. And I'm always intrigued on the different prospects of did we play 1,000 sports or did we start this honing in thing very early? I'm team play 1,000 sports. But
me too.
Yeah.
Also, he painted his fingernails at one time.
Oh, yes.
Which caused, an uproar on social media?
Yeah.
I got nothing.
It's silly. You don't need to have an opinion on this.
Right.
They got a picture of him in a basketball game or something, and his nails were painted, and that bothered some people for some reason.
We'll just have to blow up on anything and everything.
All right. You guys are you two are on the clock now for Washington.
So Washington, which a lot of – I feel like it's kind of split between Drake May and Jaden Daniels at number two. We went with – Jaden Daniels, the best dual threat of the class, kind of magician on the move. But for me, I just like the marriage with Cliff Kingsbury. He's worked with several high-level mobile quarterbacks, Patrick Mahomes and Kyler Murray. And even though, obviously, Daniels is his own player, I just like that combination of the dimension he'll add to Washington's offense.
Yeah, and I think it'll be interesting to see. He dealt with a lot of turmoil in college, whether it was from COVID stuff or the Arizona State coaching changes, all the things going on there. Does that help kind of prepare him in some ways for the fact that Washington has been undergoing all these changes as well. And again, when you're such a high pick, there's already so much pressure there. But, you know, is he a guy who, because he was able to make that change already in college and handle it really well, big stage, you know, is he ready for that? I do like that he's the guy that can scramble, the guy that can do all the athletic stuff. But sometimes I think that's a tough adjustment for guys going into the NFL when they were able to rely a little bit more on their athleticism. But can he stay in the pocket, or even if he's forced out, still go on to those further reads and not just rely on the athleticism when suddenly everyone's bigger, stronger, faster?
Go ahead.
So why didn't he have a big year until his fifth year in college?
That's what I was saying about the whole, like, there were a lot of, well, there was COVID for 1 year where they didn't even play a whole lot. And then there was all the different coaching stuff at Arizona State.
He started 27 games the previous two seasons.
Took a little bit of development.
Yeah, that's a red flag for me. Also, you know who else is mobile? Drake May. He's not Jaden Daniels.
He has functional athleticism.
No, he's a big, fast guy who's a load in the open field like Josh Allen. Bree and I have disagreed about this for the last couple of months. She likes Jaden Daniels. I think Drake May. I do agree that he has been the guy everybody expects Washington to take, although there's been a little bit of a shift in that in the public perception in the last week or so.
Right.
Leaning more towards Drake May, which is who I would personally pick. But it makes sense in a predictive mock.
Well, I just think he had the best tape of 2023, and then he kind of has there's been the comp to Lamar Jackson, but obviously kind of coming out, Lamar Jackson has a little bit more of the elusiveness, but he showcases arm talent this last year.
But he doesn't throw on the run. Every time the pocket breaks down, he just runs. He doesn't run to buy time to make big plays downfield. He just runs. He drops his eyes and just goes every time.
Well, yeah, that'll definitely be one of the developmental things they'll have to work on.
Yeah, good luck with that.
Okay, then.
I like Jaden Daniels as a quarterback prospect. I don't like him as the second pick overall, personally.
Fair enough.
And I am not big on Drake May, so, so Jeff, here we go.
Jeff, would you like to be Elliot Wolf and announce?
Yes, since you bantered on about Drake May, I think maybe that's who we should go with.
I
do think it's interesting that he's been working out with Phillip Rivers, which is kind of an interesting.
Really?
Yes, which I think is smart, because if you get with someone who's been in the NFL, there's a lot of things you don't know. You don't know what you don't know. And I think when a quarterback like Phillip Rivers, who's been around a little bit, you can say he was good, bad, or indifferent.
He was good.
But you know, people had a knock on him too, you know. The thing is that I think he shows them, you know, it's film work. It's the little things that make the big things happen. So I think that's where we're going with Drake May, and he's out of North Carolina, in case you were wondering.
Yep, which means he's also been getting some instruction from former Bucs QB coach Clyde Christensen.
Oh, okay.
A guy that's been given some instruction to some rather impressive QBs in the past.
Such as?
Such as Peyton Manning, Tom Brady.
That's true. Yeah. I thought you meant before the draft.
No. I just mean in his career.
So basically you're saying Clyde's working with the all-pros only.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
But yeah, I thought that was interesting. I think I also loved the story of how he originally was talking to Alabama, but UNC just never gave up, even after he'd essentially already committed to Alabama. And then they set up a meeting with Michael Jordan to woo him to UNC. Let me tell you, you set up a meeting with Michael Jordan, I think that's going to woo a lot of people. That was the trump card that they played there. And I just thought that was a really cool story.
I'm a little surprised to hear that, because wasn't his whole family at one point or another athletic stars for North Carolina, like his dad?
His brother was a basketball player,
made a huge but shot he was, in the tournament.
I mean, I think if you know, when it comes to football, Alabama, if you got that chance, it's hard to turn that down. But yeah, so he ultimately ended up at UNC. Michael Jordan with another win.
Interesting. Okay, good pick, Jeff. I like that one.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I think New England got lucky to get Drake May at three. I think had Drake May gone second, the Patriots probably would have listened to some phone calls about trading down to somebody like maybe the Raiders, who apparently love Jaden Daniels.
It's going to be so interesting to see what the Patriots do, because they are so famous for trading down, and it's sort of been their bread and butter. And, of course, everyone knows that if you can trade down, it is kind of a great thing most of the time. But they need a quarterback so bad, and it's going to be interesting with such a high-praise QB class, what they decide to do there. Like, do they have their guys where they just say, if it's this guy – we do it. If it's this guy, we don't.
Yeah.
Or do they just stick with their, you know, previous thoughts? But now, of course, there's some different decision makers over there than recent.
Like
so maybe
Ellie Wolf,
maybe they just change things completely.
Well, Jeff and I didn't listen to any phone calls. Once Jane Daniels went second, we knew what we were going to do. We sprinted to the podium. I think like most teams, especially teams with a history of success, the Patriots probably assume they will. It'll be a long time until they're picking in the top three again and have a chance at a franchise quarterback pick. So we did not listen.
One more thing about him that's interesting. I saw this stat. He has a 39-4 touchdown to interception ratio in the first half compared to 24-12 in the second half.
Ooh.
I thought that was interesting.
I don't like that.
Yep. I figured you wouldn't.
Well, we already turned the card in.
I know. Sorry. Just wanted to rain on your
pick. I guess we should have done our homework a little bit.
Look, you gave us grief for our number two pick, so I just had to slide that in there on you.
That's fair. Well, he's a little unpolished. But, I mean,
that's every rookie QB for the most part.
And that's,
there aren't a lot of Andrew Lucks to come along.
Right. And that was my thing with him. The erraticism, the inconsistencies in his throwing motion, like all of those things.
They can be fixed.
Yeah. I mean, he has obviously the size profile, the arm talent, all of that. But I just, he's a question mark for me.
Like,
I mean, a lot of them are, yes.
Mm-hmm. I mean, what draft was it? 2020 or 2021 where there were five quarterbacks starting with Trevor Lawrence?
Mm-hmm.
Trevor Lawrence is decent. The other four have already been traded to another team.
Right.
Zach Wilson, Trey Lance, Mac Jones, and one other that's not coming to mind right now. Okay, you guys are now on the clock for Arizona. Monty Asenfort calling the shots here.
Yes.
Great. Casey?
Wide receiver, Marvin Harrison Jr.
Yes.
Thank you.
Well, there's a stretch.
Shocking, right? I know. It's just shocking.
Did you listen to any phone calls, Monty?
Absolutely not. Get out of here with your phone calls.
Okay.
We would like...
By the way, you guys did... We did this beforehand.
Yes.
And I tried to trade up to this spot.
And we said, get out of here.
You guys did not want to hear it.
Get out of here. I mean, look, you got to help Kyler Murray out if you're going to continue to try this. And I loved how one of the descriptions I saw of Marvin Harrison Jr. said, basically, it's difficult... This was a quote I read. It is difficult to discuss him without sounding hyperbolic. Like, when you talk about him, it just sounds like you're being overzealous.
Because there's no holes in his scouting.
Yeah.
He's good at everything.
Which is what we just talked about. It feels like rookies, that's just not a thing typically, that you always have things to say, well, they got to get more polished on this, they got whatever. It's like, he's just ready. Like, he's just incredible. The routes, his just everywhere on the field, he is one of the best prospects, I feel like, a wide receiver in recent times. They've been looking to fill that Larry Fitzgerald void for a bit. The closest they got was the DeAndre Hopkins part, but by the time he was there, he wasn't quite the same thing. And I just feel like Arizona knows what it's like to have a Larry Fitzgerald and have missed it. And this could be their chance to do it all over again.
The Cardinals already have Greg Dortch. I just love saying his name.
It's pretty great.
Okay, so you two were Monty Asenfort and Jonathan Gannon, right? That's their head coach name, right?
Yes.
Was there total agreement between the two of you on this one?
Yes.
Didn't consider anybody else?
Negative.
Malik Nabers?
No.
Bree, what did you like?
Just kind of the prototypical once-in-a-generation prospect, but, I mean, I think he's a guy that he makes the low-percentage catches look effortless, and he has all of the things you want in a wide receiver, whether it's the route running, his ability to create separation, like the subtle movements, baiting guys. I mean, he has all of the above.
Okay. Cool.
And checks all the boxes.
I thought it was interesting. Arizona has only drafted two wide receivers since 2020, which is tied for the fewest in the league.
With us?
You know what? I didn't even see who they were tied with.
We have – I saw –
No. Since 2020. Yeah, you're right. It might be us.
We have definitely invested the fewest draft assets at receiver. I saw this in a tweet since like 2018, like right after Chris Godwin.
Yeah, I'd have to think. This was just since 2020. I'd have to go back and look at our stuff.
Yeah, we're
up
there.
Arizona obviously has not put a ton into this in recent years, and I think they need to.
Good. Okay, Jeff, we're on the clock for the Chargers, and we have a trade.
We do.
So you are right now your Minnesota GM, Kwesi Adofo-Mensah. Call me. I am Joe Ortiz in the first year on the job as the GM for the Chargers. The Vikings traded like a month ago and acquired a second first round pick, number 23 from Houston. And I agree with everybody who assesses that was the beginning of stockpiling ammunition in order to trade up. Okay, so call me and offer me picks 11 and 23.
I like it.
No, do it.
I'll give you picks 11 and 23.
Oh, hey. Hey, good talking to you again, Questy. You didn't even say hello. You just jumped right into it.
We're on the clock.
Ain't no chit-chat. Ain't no chit-chat.
We've discussed this before. And so you're offering me 11 and 23?
You got it.
That's not enough, man.
Really?
Yep.
You want more?
You're moving up for a quarterback. You have to pay a premium. So I want your 11 and your 23 and a second-round pick next year.
Oh, yeah, I'm all in, considering who I want.
All right, that's exactly right. That's exactly what we thought was going to happen.
You sounded like Kevin Costner in Draft Day.
Yeah, I don't want
no, I
two
want this
second-round
this.
Picks. I want 3 second-round picks.
Do you think
because
really,
I can.
Do you think there's really a lot of chit-chat during that time? They're not saying, hey, how are you? I'm fine. How's it going? Yeah, that's not happening.
Well, they probably have already laid the groundwork. If they decide to make a trade, they already know what they've agreed upon. So, but I just thought it'd be fun to have that phone call.
Sure. I was hilarious.
You know, there's probably a camera in the room, and you love seeing the GM pick up a phone and talk and then put
do
it down. Think, and he's
do you
talking
really
to
think
everybody
they're around. There? You just think they're acting.
They have to make the actual call.
Well, I know, but, you know, is the call on the camera? Is it, you know, on.
My
off
favorite
the
was during the COVID year, and you had, was it Zoom. Bill Belichick that had the dog?
Yeah.
Yes.
Perfect.
It was, oh. Perfection.
He was making great picks.
It was absolutely great.
And the Rams always have this fancy house that they draft from.
So who
or the Cardinals.
So who is Minnesota going for?
They trade up to get the quarterback of the future, having moved on from Kirk Cousins, and that's Michigan quarterback J.J. McCarthy.
I like that pick a lot.
A lot. You know, I don't think 2 months ago anybody would have expected McCarthy to go in the top five, but some teams have fallen in love with him.
Mm-hmm.
I think he's falling into a perfect situation. Kevin O'Connell is great with quarterbacks.
Right, and look at who his head coach was.
Yeah, Harbaugh, who loves him.
I thought it was funny that the comparisons for him are Kirk Cousins, and then you're talking about him going to Minnesota. They're just like, wait, we need a new one.
Slaps Kirk Cousins on the table at the store and says, give me another one of these.
Yes.
He starts right away with Justin Jefferson and Jordan Addison and a good tight end whose name is escaping me.
TJ Hockenson.
Hockenson. He's got a decent offensive line in front of him. It's a great situation, and not every quarterback falls into a great situation. Like, is it a great situation for Jaden Daniels in Washington? We'll see. But it looks awesome for J.J. McCarthy here. I think this is a win-win for everybody.
School record career completion percentage, and I love to see that. When you talk about, again, the decision-making – coming out of college, that's still one of the knocks against him. It's interesting. He has such a high completion percentage, but people say that his decision-making still needs to evolve, which I think is interesting. Typically, those numbers don't go against each other like that. But I also love Harbaugh has called him the Iceman for the way he stays cool under pressure.
I love that.
I'm like, that's such a Harbaugh
there's
line.
There's only one Matty Ice. You can't. You got to do it somewhere.
He just retired too.
That's what brought it up.
Yeah, he does seem kind of like a stronger and bigger Kirk Cousins, which has.
He's
you know,
bigger?
A little bit, yeah.
Wow. I didn't know he was bigger. And Kirk Cousins is not a small guy.
No, he's not.
Yeah. So it's good.
On to the next pick.
Yeah.
Clock ran out.
All right, for the good old New York Giants, we went with another receiver, but this time with Malik Nabers.
Yeah, because it couldn't be Marvin Harrison.
Yeah, but went good on kind of the same train. But big fan, and he led the SEC in receptions each of the previous two seasons, and he finished as LSU's all-time leader in receptions and receiving yards. But he's a guy that I just love what potentially he could do in the Giants offense, kind of become that gadget guy. He's kind of a menace on the jet sweeps, the reverses, but it's just kind of electric after the catch, that gliding agility. So I'm big Nabers fan.
Yeah, big playmaker. I always think that's if you're going to take a wide receiver in the first round, to know it's a guy that can do some explosive plays.
Right.
I think that's, I thought it was so interesting. I saw a quote that he said his favorite play in the playbook was the jet sweep, and I was like, that's fascinating. I don't feel like you hear a lot of wide receivers say that probably, but just loves to be able to use the, just make some of those dynamic plays, get out in open field, accelerate, decelerate, I don't know, but yeah, I think it's interesting that also the Giants, their offense finished last in pass plays of 10 yards or more. and 29th in offensive points scored, 27th in yards per pass attempt. Well, so I think this is a reasonable choice to try to fix that.
Right.
Well, that's because they were trying to play the season with like 7 slot receivers.
Yeah.
And some Tommy DeVito, is that his name? Starting like
yes.
5 games?
Yep. Yep.
So, yes, he is somebody that the Giants have needed for a long time. Now, question, if any of those top 4 quarterbacks had been there, would you all have considered that?
That's tough, man. I mean,
feels like there's only 1 year left on the Daniel Jones experience.
I agree.
Yeah.
But I feel like this is a good way to to figure that out. Give him a wide receiver.
Right.
Give him like a dynamic talent. And recently they've invested a lot more in their offensive line. So I feel like now it's like, okay, you've invested a lot in that.
Yeah.
Now you get the wide receiver. Now if it still doesn't work, I think you have your answer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well.
So.
I think he's going to have to be amazing for them not to move on.
Right.
But that's Daniel Jones I'm talking about.
Right. Well,
and I just feel like neighbors, too, in the way that offenses are evolving with more of the horizontal stretch, the pre-snap motion, all of that, and kind of what they're forcing defenses to do, I feel like he's a perfect mold of the way that the NFL is going and what he's going to potentially be able to do
in that regard. I could see why a receiver would love a jet sweep, because on most of their plays, whether they get the ball or not is somewhat out of their control.
Right, jet sweep is a little bit easier.
Jet sweep, you know you're getting the ball.
Yeah, but he also did have... He led the FBS with 34 catches of 20-plus yards. So he definitely knows how to do some of that explosive play action.
Yeah, I love the pick. Yeah. Okay, you're Rand Carthon now. Jeff, tell us who the Titans are picking.
Well, we're going to go with an offensive lineman.
Yeah, there's a lot of them.
Well, this one's a good one. This is Joe Alt. And the reason why is I'm kind of like John Lynch in this particular thing. I like bloodlines because his dad played 13 seasons for the Giants. His dad's name's John.
He was great.
You know, this kid's from Notre Dame, so you know he's a smart guy.
did you just boo Notre Dame?
Yeah, he just did. No. Jeez. Well, that's because he went to Northwestern.
No, it has nothing to do with
that. Oh, okay.
I was trying to think. I was like, I don't think they're rivals.
Yeah.
Like, I was trying to figure it out.
I was born in Norman, Oklahoma, because my dad was a graduate student at University of Oklahoma.
Okay.
Oklahoma set the all-time record for consecutive victories by an NCAA football team. They lost to Notre Dame. Won however many games it was in a row, and then lost to Notre Dame again.
Oh, no.
I think that's called scarred for life.
Yeah.
But anyways, we're going to go with Joe.
Yeah, we have to. Tennessee's number one need by far is an offensive tackle, and I would say their number two need is probably another offensive tackle.
Yes.
They are barren and bereft at the position. This is the easiest pick in the entire
game. I don't think you can pass up what you believe is a good offensive line.
Right.
Well, especially for them, yeah.
And they get to take the first one on their board.
Right.
Which is incredible.
Joe Alt is a left tackle, so they fill the more important one of the two right off the bat.
And right.
Last year's left tackle allowed 12 sacks.
And was that Petit Frere or whatever?
Yikes. Oh, I've forgotten his name already.
Or was it Andre Dillard?
Dillard was their left. Petit Frere was one of the other guys.
One of the guys is right. Yeah. Dillard was a failed guy for the Eagles. A failed first-round pick for the Eagles, and then they signed him as a free agent. Like, oh, this should work. Did not work.
And then, I mean, they hired a new offensive line coach who's considered a really good one in the league. Like, you can tell they're really realizing, like, we gotta do something here.
Well, the O-line coach they hired is the father of the new head coach.
Yeah, Bill
Callahan.
Famous.
Very famous
coach.
Mm-hmm. And the head coach of the Raiders.
Oakland Raiders in the Super Bowl.
I like that Joe Alt, at one point in his football career when he was younger, has played quarterback, linebacker, D-line, and tight end.
Yeah.
I love that. Like, that guy is going to know, I'm telling you, quarterback, when he was, like, he...
He just loves the game.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's in his blood, coach.
It's in his blood.
I'm a big believer in the same way I'm a multi-sport supporter. I'm also a multi-position supporter. Like, when I found out Chris Godwin grew up playing offensive line, I'm like, this all tracks. Like, I love this idea. So I love this idea that he's played all these things.
We already have two sons of former NFLers, because Marvin Harrison was too.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, my favorite thing I think I read on that pick is that it was suspiciously clear that he's going to be the pick for the Titans.
Suspiciously clear?
Yes. It's like, love that.
Yeah. Okay, so Atlanta and Terry Fontenot are on the clock. I tried again to make a trade up to this spot, but they did not want to move from it. So what did you do instead?
We went with good old Edge in Dallas Turner.
Alabama?
From Alabama.
Yep. New era.
Why is he the first edge off the board
for them? He He does kind of lack a little bit of the size for NFL standards, but he has that quickness off the ball, physical at the point of attack, was the SEC 2023 Defensive Player of the Year, the speed to power conversion, and he's just kind of a guy that has those explosive traits that in the high upside that teams covet. So he was my first off the board.
Yeah, I like that he's lined up in both a two and a three-point stance. And it's also cool. He apparently had kind of a mentor relationship with last year's first-round pick, Will Anderson Jr. They're also best friends. And always love when they have someone like that that's already gone to the league that can help. And I just know that this feels like a pick that specifically Raheem Morris would love. And right. that how nice for him coming in as more of a defensive-minded coach that they have done such incredible work offensively in recent drafts. Like, they have done so many big splashy offensive spots, and that this has already been such an offensive heavy start to a draft. When you aren't necessarily in need of the big splashy type of offensive spots, you can go in for a premier edge guy like this and take whoever you want your first one to be.
Kind of amazing that they're picking in the top 10 for the fourth year in a row.
I'm sure they don't love it, but it has some nice benefits for them.
So you didn't think for a minute that they might go Kyle Pitts, what's the big receiver?
Brock Bowers. The receiver.
The last three picks. Bijan Robinson last year. I can't think of the receiver's name right now. And Kyle Pitts, the tight end, the receiver, and the running back all in the top eight. And you didn't want to give them like Roma Dunze or anything?
Yeah, I mean, that would have been just gluttonous at this point, I feel like, after what they've done. And I mean, and then they also added Kirk Cousins. It's like, you've done all the things. You've done all the offensive things. So let's make a big defensive splash.
They get the very first defensive player off the board, and they've been searching for edge rush, juice for a long time now. Mm-hmm. So it makes a lot of sense.
Thank you.
All right. At number nine, the Bears are ecstatic that they not only get their quarterback of the future, but they get one of the big three receivers in Roma Dunze from Washington. There's a lot of disagreement out there in the mock draft or the NFL draft analyst community about, is Neighbors the second best or is Dunze the second best? So you get him at nine, I think it's a home run for the Bears.
Mm-hmm.
You like the pick, Jeff?
Yes.
And time will tell who's right on it.
So just a couple years ago, the Bears had one of the worst wide receiver rooms in the league. Yeah. Now they have Keenan Allen.
DJ Moore.
Yeah, mm-hmm. DJ Crazy. Moore. And then Roma Dunze, that's nice.
And considering I do feel like Odunze would be in any other draft,
could
maybe
be
number one on it. Like, that's one of those things where this is such a deep wide receiver group here at the top to feel like a lot of drafts, I always feel like you've got to be frustrated when you're picking that high and you're not getting the first of a position.
Yeah.
That's got to just be really frustrating. Yeah. But this year it's like, man, this guy,
but we're fine with it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Good point. All right, you guys are up. Joe Douglas of the Jets is on the clock.
Ooh.
It's year two of the Aaron Rodgers experience.
Yes.
Casey?
And we'll be ready for the fifth play of his illustrious career.
That's exactly right.
So, tight end Brock Bowers from Georgia to further the all-in Aaron Rodgers experience.
Yes.
When his comparison is George Kittle, how do you not want that for a guy like Aaron Rodgers? Big-time pass catcher. Good skills and just could really be such a star if he lands with the right kind of quarterback and play caller and all of that. But of course it's like, this is the whole point is that they're trying to go all in with Rodgers. And so some people say like, oh man, do you want to take a tight end this high in a draft? That's a lot. But I think that when they know like this may be it,
mm-hmm.
who cares where you're taking him? If you feel like this is the piece that could put you over the edge, that you've just, if you look at their free agency signings, like you can just tell everything is designed to help Rodgers this year. And you're signing Tyrone mm-hmm. Smith and John Simpson, trading for Morgan Moses. You're trying to boost your offensive line. Mike Williams signed as a free agent to upgrade their receiver group. So if you're all in, why not? Even if it is a little high for a tight end, who cares?
Mm-hmm.
Can I play a little devil's advocate here?
Yes, and then I'm going to come back against you. But
I love Brock Bowers. I love Brock Bowers. Not saying anything about Brock Bowers, but you know what George Kittle was?
Hmm.
He was a fifth-round draft pick.
Right.
We're talking about positional value here.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And you want to hear some of the last recent first-round picks at tight end?
Hmm.
Hayden Hurst, O.J. Howard, Evan Ingram, David Njoku, Eric Ebron, Tyler Eifert, Jermaine Gresham, Brandon Pettigrew, Dustin Keller.
So my pushback on it, and I agree with you.
Kyle Pitts, yeah, supposed Pitts. To be the best
I agree
ever.
With you. Yeah. But typically, if you are getting taken in the first round, like high as a tight end, you might be going to a team that doesn't have great stuff around you. Like it doesn't have the quarterback or it doesn't have, you know, for him to get to go to a team that has an Aaron Rodgers might be very different than some of those other situations.
Yeah. Like Hayden Hurst with Lamar Jackson.
Mm-hmm. Minus that. But yeah, I agree. I mean, I think it is in any other situation, I'd say, yeah, it's too high. But again, if you're all in, I'm just kind of like, you know,
yeah,
I get it.
Well, and for me, it's when you look at what he's going to be able to do. Like, he's another chess piece for Nathaniel Hackett, but also he's great with kind of the quick touches, which can help protect Aaron Rodgers, you know, where you're not having the prolonged dropbacks, but also just his ability to kind of create the mismatches, the ability against safeties, against linebackers, and just his skill set as a whole. I think he's going to make a really, really big impact for New York.
Yeah, because rookie tight ends always have huge impacts. You guys made a point. You made the exact point that the GM, Joe Douglas, and the head coach are all in because if they don't win this year, they could be gone. And you draft a player at a position where they rarely make big impacts as a rookie.
Yeah.
But I will say, I think traditionally in the past, they haven't had as much success because at the college ranks, they're treated as either essentially like an extension of the offensive line or a glorified big slot receiver. They're either one or the other. But now, and then, of course, in the NFL, you're asked to do all of the above and you have a lot more on your plate. Mm-hmm. You're looking at a lot more things. Yeah. You're looking at protections. You're looking at routes.
Right.
But now they're coming in having a better understanding and framework to work off of at the NFL level.
I think
I don't follow that.
Scott thinks you just made his point.
I do.
I think she's saying that recently
the clock is running out. The clock is running out.
That's true. We need to move on. We're only 10 picks in, guys.
I just, you know, they signed two tackles. This is one of the best tackle drafts in a long time. They signed two tackles who are notably injury prone. There's no way that those two guys, Tyron Smith and Morgan Moses, are going to make it through the season.
Oh, definitely not. I saw Tyron Smith many years in Dallas.
All right,
and yeah,
Jeff's
that's
right.
Not happening.
Jeff's right. We got to move on. The Chargers, after moving down to 11, I led this pick here because it's not really what you normally see. You usually see them taking a tackle or a wide receiver, but I think teams are in love with Byron Murphy, the defensive lineman from Texas. Mm-hmm. And if you look around the league at the best defensive linemen, which defensive tackles essentially, they're hard to find and they almost always come from the first round.
Right.
And this is considered the best one out there. It's a big part of the need for the Chargers, and Jim Harbaugh loves the trenches. He could take a tackle here, of course, but they have another pick later in the round. I think they go for the blue chip at this position.
Yeah, and hopefully he'll be there because there have been reports that Chicago Bears really like this kid.
That's
they
a good
like
point.
Him a lot. And so,
you're
again,
right.
That's where the draft's kind of who, if he's available, this is who they're going to take. But that's an if.
Yeah, no, I don't see him commonly pair with him, and you're right. His stock has gone through the roof recently.
Yeah.
Which I think is everybody outside of the teams realizing how important teams value that position and how much they like this guy.
Yeah. He was recently named a dark horse to go in the top 10.
Dark horse.
Yeah.
And it seems like he is going to be talented against both the pass and the run, which again, you know, I remember we talked about this so much with Kalijah last year. Did people think he could do both? To have a defensive lineman, you feel strongly about being able to do both. But I will say it's going to be interesting to see if the Chargers, this is my one thing, is I feel like they would want one of these wide receivers.
Yeah, okay. And spoiler, good point. Very good point. And spoiler alert, I didn't mean to cut you off. But they have two, they traded down and had two picks, and we made both of them, Jeff and I.
Mm-hmm.
And afterwards, I'm like, how did we come away from this draft without a receiver?
Without a receiver, yeah.
That's my fault, Jeff.
No, that's fine.
I was literally thinking that last night as I was looking at this.
Yep.
Like, and I don't know how I did that. I mean, I like the two players we got, but how did they not? There's some good receivers left, but there's not, you know, the cream of the crop is gone.
Correct. Mm-hmm. Correct. Okay, we went through the top 10. We've done really, really well. Now we're going to pick up the pace.
All right, that, okay. We've done 11 picks.
Okay.
Yes. Pick up the pace.
Jeff wants us to give it.
Well, no, but the top 10, there's a little more detail to it as you go along.
So now we can chop.
All right, let's do the next four in rapid order. So Denver, George Payton is on the
Yes.
clock.
And we did. Okay.
I didn't pick this guy because I didn't want to pronounce his name.
Yeah, thank you. So it's Taliesa? Taliesa Fuaga?
I think so.
Okay. Well, that's what.
Sure.
That's what we're going to go with. And there is kind of the. No. There is kind of the notion of a potential trade up for a quarterback with Bo Nix or Michael Penix, but I'm not really convinced that after McCarthy, you're going to have another quarterback go in the first round. So I'm going with Fuaga.
Well, and
on
they
this
just
one.
Signed Zach Wilson. I mean,
yeah, that too. That too.
They're to ready. What is it? Let's ride.
Jared yes. Stidham. Jared Stidham, Zach Wilson, and Ben DiNucci.
Whoever you have there, you need to give them a better line. You might as well. I mean, my philosophy is always any quarterback can make a throw if given time. So. Yep. I believe in the tackle part.
All right. Tom Telesco gets fired by the Chargers and is immediately hired by the Raiders. So he's on the clock here. Jeff, who does he take?
Sorry. What's that?
I'll announce it.
13?
13. Yes. Cornerback. Go ahead.
Mitchell.
Quinyon Mitchell. Mitchell. Toledo. So where the Falcons got their number one edge rusher and the Chargers got their number one interior defensive lineman, the Raiders get because this is such an offensive top-heavy draft, they get the first cornerback off the board at 13, which rarely happens. The first cornerback almost always goes in the top 10.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And I think that's a position of need for them. It's kind of easy. This was an easy one for me.
Well, yeah, but everybody's looking for a corner, so.
Always.
This
always.
Is going to be interesting because he does just, I mean, most productive defensive back in their school's history. He's got all sorts of ball skills and athleticism and, 43 passes defensed and 6 interceptions over the last 27 games is wild.
Mm-hmm. Great production.
But struggled a bit when played some tougher competition like Ohio State. So whenever you see a school like Toledo, that's what you always kind of wonder is like, college to pro is always a jump.
Yeah.
You know, so.
I hear you, but I
but
think.
But I still agree with you. I think it's a great pick.
I think what made teams feel better about it is he dominated against that type of competition at the Senior Bowl.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Since the Senior Bowl.
The Senior Bowl seems to be a game changer for a lot of
it's
guys.
It's huge it for small school guys.
Right.
Well, and sort of like for us with Jamal Dean, he also has what a lot of people don't, which is their recovery speed. We're in a 4.33 at the combine.
Yeah.
So that's also a big thing to circle for that.
Like the Senior Bowl.
Speed demon.
That's where the Bucs started to fall in love with Ali Marpet.
Yeah.
Of Hobart College.
Mm-hmm.
We know how that worked out. Okay, now on the clock, New Orleans. We hope they get a terrible player, Mickey Loomis.
Unfortunately, it seems like they don't get a terrible player. It seems like they get a tackle, Olu Fashanu.
Fashanu.
Yes.
The emphasis is on the wrong syllable.
Exactly.
From Penn State. I mean, he's, I think, going to be a little bit of a work in progress as a run blocker, but pass protection, phenomenal. And look, poor Derek Carr. Look, far be it for me to have sympathy for anything related to the Saints, obviously. But poor Derek Carr got absolutely destroyed last year. Got just pounded into the turf many a time. They've got to give him some more protection. Mm-hmm. They don't have a true starter right now at either tackle position.
Right. Trevor Penning's a disaster.
So they got to do it.
Ryan and for me, what's so impressive about him is obviously a technician, but he finished his collegiate career with 0 sacks allowed on 733 pass blocking snaps over 29 games.
Dang. Not
that's
too
incredibly
shabby.
Impressive.
I mean, 0, that's a good number.
That's
yeah.
I mean, it sounds great, you know.
If you ever want 0 to be a good number,
yes,
that's the one.
Yep.
Yes. Well, so that's it's unfortunately a good pick, and their right tackle Ryan Ramczyk may not play this year. Mm-hmm. Trevor Penning hasn't really worked out yet, so it's one of the easier pairings.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Earlier when you guys were talking about Byron Murphy being a dark horse for a top 10 pick, I wanted to go off on a tangent about how that song by Katy Perry makes no sense at all, but Jeff wants us to move along, so I'll skip it.
Oh, but I want this
one.
Tangent, though.
We'll
that sounds so
we
intriguing.
We can save it at the end.
I need this after
if
going.
People want to stick around for the end, hear his Katy Perry tape.
That's called the after show.
Yeah, yes. The after show. So,
the walk off.
Chris Ballard and Indianapolis are on the clock. They kind of were hoping Brock Bowers would fall here. He didn't because the Jets made a rash decision. And so they go with the second cornerback on their board, Alabama's Terrion Arnold.
Mm.
They need a corner.
I'm all in.
Good.
From Alabama. I mean, how bad can you?
The first of two Alabama corners are probably going to go here.
Yeah, they surrendered way too many big plays last year. 23rd in both yards per pass attempt allowed and in pass breakups. So they need a playmaking guy. And he's got he's got the ball skills, got some cover athleticism.
Mm-hmm. 5 interceptions, 12 passes defense in 2023. Yeah.
And I think he can work inside or outside, which is always nice, too, if you're going to spend a high draft pick on a corner. to know you could use him wherever?
On the Colts' current depth chart, one of their two starting corners is a undrafted free agent from a couple years ago named Dallas Flowers.
Yeah, they struggle.
They need this.
They struggle big time.
All right, the Chargers. Now, this is actually our pick again because of the trade. The Chargers, we have another trade now. The Chargers traded back up from 23 to 16. They gave Seattle, who loves to trade back, they gave them a third this year, which we looked at the chart, and the difference in the values of the picks is almost was pick number 70, and this is pick number 69. But you usually have to pay a little bit more to move up that many spots in the first round, so they also gave a third-round pick next year. So two third-round picks for the Chargers to move back up to 16, where they probably should have taken a wide receiver in retrospect. But I knew they needed a right tackle. They're set at left tackle because they have one of Northwestern's finest, at Rashawn Slater, on that side. But they really need a right tackle. I love Amarius Mims. I think he's obviously raw. He's only started 8 games in college.
I find that fascinating that with all the research with drafts that we do, that like this guy's got so few snaps on tape.
Small sample size.
Yeah, we're just making. I mean, these decisions are so big for these franchises.
But he made the best of his snaps.
Yeah.
Also, he's huge.
Yeah.
Well,
and moves like he's not huge.
Yeah. 6'8", 340. Just stand there. You don't have to do anything. Just be in the way.
Just try to go around me.
His height, weight,
stick
length,
the arms
profile.
Out wide.
Yeah. Extremely impressive.
Wingspan, good wingspan.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's obviously a little rawer than some of these other prospects, and J.C. Latham might have been a consideration there. He's also a right tackle, but I went with the maybe bigger upside.
No, I'm with you, and if you hit on O-linemen, then you can have a so-so quarterback and still do well.
He also allowed 0 sacks. Now, this was only
8 games.
8 games, but
again,
also 0.
Again. I also allowed 0 sacks.
Yes. That's what I want to put on my social media profile. 0 sacks allowed in the NFL.
But see, the difference is you have 0 games.
Yeah.
At least he's got 8 games.
Yeah.
You guys got that right. That was the joke.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Hilarious.
We're back on the clock again with Trent Baalke of Jacksonville, and they go with a cornerback, another position need for them as well. And we went with the very versatile Cooper DeJean of Iowa. He might be able to play several positions for them. He might play safety. He could play slot. But there's plenty of scouts that believe he can stick
outside
corner.
I don't know. There's something about going to Jacksonville that things just don't go right, no matter where you're picked and no matter what. I don't know what it is. So, you know.
He seems
pretty
solid.
I really like him.
I know. I like him, too.
Everybody likes whoever gets.
Swiss Army knife for the Hawkeyes.
But once they get there, things don't go so well.
He allowed only one catch of 15-plus yards in 2023.
But it's not zero.
Yeah, it's not zero. But he did play some games. Yeah, I think also the fact that he's got that special teams potential.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact, it seems like he could do corner, safety, nickel, all the things, which, again, you love a high
but that whole versatility. That whole special teams thing is going to change.
Mm-hmm. I think, if anything, it values it more, though.
Yes. Right. Yeah. Well, yes. And that's going to be.
Because now you need multiple returners or you need.
Correct. And it's going to be the first year. And then I think next year when you see the draft, you're going to start seeing people focusing more on people who can also play special teams.
Right. But I think the thing with him, too, is that he's solid against the run. He takes the effective pursuit angles. He's not a guy that, okay, well, we know he's not going to be quite as good against the run, so we can just consistently target him. He's a guy that is going to be a physical tackler.
It'll be interesting to see. I mean, Jacksonville, they've got a new defensive coordinator, so you always wonder what they're going to do. What is that going to look like? Because Iowa did play mainly zone. And so to see how does that translate if they're taking him, like how much zone are they playing, how much man, and then how do they feel like that translates.
Right.
And the Jaguars, they don't have Darius Williams anymore, so they really only have one starting corner. He's pretty good, Tyson Campbell.
Is that enough, Scott? Is that enough corners?
That is not enough.
Never enough corners, particularly when there's only one.
I mean, the other guys on the depth chart here might argue with me, but I've never heard of them, so.
Anyway, well, they might not have heard of you either, in fairness.
All right, that's 3 picks in a row for us, but now you guys are back on the clock for the Cincinnati Bengals.
Mm-hmm. And they don't necessarily need a tackle with their bookends in place, but Trent Brown has only played a full season once in the last 5 years.
And just has a 1-year deal.
Yes, not great. So, and Latham's a guy that, you know, is stout in pass protection, the unique blend of mass and power, smooth in transition. It's a guy that I think will really bolster their line.
Yep, I think they want to keep Joe Burrow healthy.
Yeah,
I think
keep him upright in the pocket.
They're just the way you feel about corners is almost how I feel about offensive linemen.
That's fair.
You just cannot have enough. It is going to be interesting, too. He's lost a little bit of weight ahead of the draft. He was playing at 6'6", 360, but he says he's lost like 25 pounds or so. So that'll be interesting to see. And he's recovering from that injury at the end of Rose Bowl, but I think he seems good to go. But yeah, I think that'll be interesting to see. But I'm a big fan of keep Joe Burrow upright. NFL is more fun to watch when Joe Burrow is upright.
Very true.
Yeah. Their Super Bowl window is probably still open. So probably, as Joe Burrow would say, it's always open when he's there.
Exactly. When he's upright.
Hey, J.C. Latham, the only thing here, and I love the pick, his stock seems to be rising. I've heard him listed as potentially even somebody, if whoever takes the first tackle wants a right tackle, they might go with Latham over Joe Alt. So, like, if the Chargers went tackle, maybe they go Latham. Anyway, his stock appears to be on the rise, but if he's there, I think it's a home run for them.
Yep.
All right, Jeff, you're Les Snead now for the Rams, picking in the first round.
I was going to say, man, we haven't said this in years.
You know when the last time the Rams picked in the first round was, Jeff?
What, 5-6 years ago?
It's been a minute. I'm thinking about this. I want to say it might be 2017?
2016.
16. God, went back and forth between the two.
Jared Goff. Last time.
That's what I was trying to remember is when he was drafted, and I couldn't come up with the year.
You were very close.
That's crazy.
It's
but
wild.
You know that what? They won a Super Bowl during that time, so I guess.
As Les Snead has said, F them picks.
Yeah.
Wow. Have you seen his own coffee mug that says that? That someone bought him this coffee mug that says that because he said that multiple times.
That's right.
This wasn't me making this up.
Sure.
The record to show.
Incredible.
The funny thing about that, though, is in terms of bulk, the Rams have made a ton of picks. It's just they've often been third, fourth, fifth, sixth rounders. Yeah. And they've hit on a number of those, which is how they've done
it. They just had plans on those Thursdays for a lot of years. And they were just like, look, we really don't like having to work the draft 3 days.
I need to wash my hair on Thursday.
Yes. So what is Les Snead going to do in his first round pick?
They just have an intern in there marking off the picks on Thursday night.
Yeah, while they're all out hanging out.
All right, Jeff.
Okay. I'm not sure how to say his first name. Jerzon?
I think it's Jerzon, but they also call him Johnny.
Johnny Newton. He's 6'1", 300 pounds, which isn't exactly the biggest guy, but he has great quickness.
So I don't know if you have ever heard of a guy named Aaron Donald.
Well, there you go.
But he was also said to not have the greatest size, but had some quickness. I feel like I love that you guys have the Rams just immediately being like, we would like another Aaron Donald, please.
Yep.
And I can't imagine the pressure for this guy if this is who they take.
They need to tell him you're coming. You're Johnny Newton.
Yeah.
We don't expect you to be Aaron Donald.
No. Yeah.
Right.
Just be your best Johnny
He gets
Newton.
Off pass rushers. He gets off the block really quick. He likes to win by his hands on the blocker. Uses a push and pull method.
Wow.
Yeah.
I think
he's going to be okay.
They did.
And they need to do something because you know who retired.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And they did hit last year with a later round pick in Kobe Turner,
yeah. He had 7.5 sacks and 52 total tackles, which is not bad at all for the 89th pick in the draft.
Yeah.
So if you pair these two guys together, so he tied the mark for – I'm sorry, I was saying that Jerzon Newton, those were his stats. Kobe tied the mark for sacks that Aaron Donald set in his rookie year with 9.
Wow.
9 sacks his rookie year as the 89th pick.
Amazing.
So to pair these two guys together would be
– right.
I think the Rams have learned having a scary defensive line, very handy.
Mm-hmm. I love when we make a pick and then Casey and Bree tell us how great it was.
Yeah, I
well,
know.
Well, no, I mean, he's
I appreciate it.
He's known as the most nuanced pass rusher in the class, and he had 103 pressures over the previous two seasons, the most by any FBS interior lineman.
All right, moving to pick
love
20.
It.
We're at pick 20. Are we doing okay now, Jeff?
Yeah,
we're picking
it up. Yeah, we picked it up.
Okay,
and
so
we keep going now.
Pittsburgh, Omar Khan, Casey.
Guard. Graham Barton from Duke played left tackle and center in college. Seems to be valued a little bit more at center, but could play all the interior with some versatility. The Steelers, you know, they've got some veteran guards they've added recently, but no center since they cut their former starter. So this is just a big old need pick.
Bam. Stick him right in there.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Shove him in that center spot. There we go.
Yep. I like that pick a lot. All right. Is that enough? Do you have more to say about that?
No, that's more something.
Graham Barton, another guy that has commonly been mocked to the Buccaneers. In fact, I think you might have even done that one time.
I did, yes.
Okay.
I did.
Jeff, you and I are Chris Greer for Miami. Man, he's been there a long time.
Yep.
Who does Chris want?
He wants a wide receiver. He wants one really bad. And Brian Thomas, LSU.
I was the driving force on this pick, and I don't feel like it's something you commonly see. Miami often takes an interior defensive lineman, but both of those guys were gone. They could use offensive line help, but what else does Miami like? They love speed.
And he's a 4-3-3.
Yeah, this just feels unfair. Yeah. Like, I mean, good grief. Like, you have Hill and Waddle. Like, leave some for the rest of
well,
us.
Well, yeah, but you got to have someone to take a break. You know, when they run that fast, they got to step out.
Yeah, they got to take a minute.
But you don't miss anything.
Yeah.
I like the pick.
Yeah, and I think it's they might address the trenches unless they feel like this wide receiver class is just too good to pass up. I feel like Miami specifically, their GM is the best player guy. That apparently his philosophy is to address every position of need in free agency in some way, so that the draft can just be whoever floats your boat the most in that moment. And obviously, they've seen that it's pretty fun to have those kind of speedy wide receivers. So let's just throw another one.
And
in there.
The wide receivers are so speedy; the offensive linemen don't need to block as long.
Well, you're not making a joke, right?
No,
because that's
true.
Yeah. The amazing thing about
how you say you're not making a joke.
Well, I thought you were at first, but the amazing thing about the Miami offense when it's working as it's supposed to is they get downfield depth of target, but they do it so much faster.
Mm-hmm.
So usually, your quarterback, you don't have both downfield depth of target leading the league in that and also quick getting rid of the ball. Those two things, but they're so fast. Tyreek Hill gets
you have
fast.
Both. Mm-hmm.
And now you have Brian Thomas, who was almost as fast as the record-setting Xavier Worthy.
Right, can take the
And he's
off.
Like 40 pounds heavier than Xavier Worthy.
Yeah.
So maybe it was a luxury pick, but I just couldn't pass it up.
Yep.
All right. You guys.
It's Miami. Eagles. They're about luxury.
Yeah. Yes. And then Eagles, we took Nate Wiggins. Love this guy. And he's randomly kind of been linked to the Bucs in recent mocks as well.
Okay.
But the Eagles have not taken a corner in the first round since, do you know?
I know it's been a while.
It is Lito Shepherd in 2002.
Lito Shepherd.
Whoa,
I
in 2002.
Yes. So, but they're going to bolster the back end. But he's a guy, and again, absolutely huge fan of this guy, his tape. But the 2023 matchup against Star Hills, this is a guy, he raced 64 yards downfield and forced a fumble at the goal line, punching the ball out. A guy that kind of like we've seen over
we
and over
call that
with
the Antoine Winfield.
Yeah, Antoine Winfield. Just can single-handedly change the course of the game. Only allowed one catch of 20-plus yards on 41 targets last season. Smoothing out of breaks, urgency.
Yep.
Really like this guy.
And the Eagles surrendered the second most passing yards in the NFL last season.
Yeah.
So
and the cornerbacks are getting long in the tooth.
Yes. Yeah, and which is nice. He would get to develop behind Darius Slay, James Bradbury. Like, that's great when you get a chance to learn behind guys like that.
Right.
But you know that it's like you probably are going to have to look at the future a little bit coming up.
Good pick. Okay. You guys are back on the clock because this was Seattle's pick originally at 16.
So, yes. We have them taking tackle Troy Fautanu?
That's what I wanted you to, I didn't want to say that.
I heard you just,
Fautanu?
Fautanu.
Fautanu.
That's what I said. Totally what I said. So, I mean, look, they lost multiple starters on the line in free agency. And I love this. He played for their offensive coordinator and O-line coach in college. I mean, talk about some nice consistency there.
Mm-hmm.
That's very handy out of Washington. So,
cool.
I think that this feels like such a perfect fit for all parties involved.
So, John Schneider moves down like he always does and still gets his man.
Mm-hmm.
And he's played tackle and guard, so.
Always handy.
Yeah, that's right.
He's
one of these guys that's
considering,
and they could use a little help.
Correct.
Both, so
correct.
You get him in the building and figure out what the best combination is.
He's a tweener.
And you another a third pick and roll for y'all for the Cowboys?
Yes.
I'll let you handle this.
I'm not going to lie. I was pained to take Jackson Powers Johnson for Dallas because that takes him off the board potentially because I also love him for us. And I think he plays with kind of the demeanor, the tenacity that Jason Light obviously loves in his offensive lineman. But Cowboys have a hole at center. And at left tackle, but Tyler Biotis, who kind of manned that post for them for the majority of the last three seasons, is now gone. But he's just kind of became the fifth unanimous All-American selection in school history. Just plays with kind of that same fiery disposition as the Ryan Jensen here with us, but just kind of moves defenders back, powerful upper body. Excellent initial quickness, like finishing mentality, immense power, smooth footwork, checks all the boxes, heavy anchor. Love this pick for the Cowboys.
I concur.
Okay.
I could say more, but I feel like she covered it.
You kind of, and they just lost their center, Tyler Biotis.
Yes.
And Tyron Smith. They just need an O-lineman in general.
Yeah.
And especially if you are investing, if depending on what all the contract stuff happens. Like,
right.
You are you going to invest in your wide receiver, your quarterback, all these people long term? Like, again, you can never have too many offensive linemen.
Well, and they have a solid history of hitting on linemen, whether it was Zach Martin, Tyron Smith.
Tyler Smith.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
If their name is Smith, draft them. I'm surprised they haven't drafted you, Scott.
I didn't declare.
Yeah. Did you tell them you had zero sacks?
Actually, okay. Geez. So now we're Jeff and I, this is one of the ones we struggled with the most, Green Bay, when we got here. Just there wasn't an obvious pick. Eventually just decided cornerback was an area of need for them and went with Alabama's Kool-Aid McKinstry. It was one of our least, like, sure picks. Mm-hmm. I just didn't know what to do here. Did you like this pick, Jeff?
Hey, look, if you're going by Kool-Aid, I'm all in.
It is a good name.
That's fair.
Yeah.
He's got a point.
It's a very, you know, the original Kool-Aid commercial.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Was Kool-Aid, yeah. Kool-Aid, tastes great. Kool-Aid, Kool-Aid, can't wait.
If they don't announce him like
that. I'm all in.
And they got to bust through the wall.
And if he doesn't bust through a wall, cheese wall, go through the cheese, a brick of cheese, and go through it. I mean, I'm all in on this guy.
I wouldn't mind a cheese wall.
There you go.
I mean, depending on.
I think I need that in my life, to be honest.
What kind, though?
I'm not gonna lie. I'm a cheese connoisseur, so I want all of the above. I want pepper jack. I want Gouda. I want Havarti. I want mozzarella. I want
the bougie
Parmesan.
Cheese.
Brie.
How did you
obviously for, you know,
how did
we
not say that first?
Me, if I'm running through a brick wall, I want Swiss.
But I want I just
sense.
Want all the
you're thinking practically
all the cheese.
She
and
was
then
thinking
I want
what she would eat as she ran
as
through
well.
It. You went
as
to
well.
How did the charcuterie board at your party go the other night?
My God, it was absolutely stupendous. But the really not great thing though is that now I have an infinity of cheese in my fridge and an abundance of crackers that
sounds
I
like
don't
like
need.
Not a problem at all.
But it's fine.
That sounds like a murder of crows. An infinity of cheese.
Yes.
A flock of cheese. All right. So now what we've all been waiting for, Jason Light and the Buccaneers are on the clock.
Yes.
Ladies.
Glad this isn't my pick.
Go ahead, Bree.
All righty. And
You struggled.
I did struggle.
But
let's be honest.
Not because she didn't. There were more options here than you expected.
Yes. Yes. So you had Latu still there, and you also had Jared Verse, and I debated for a long time, didn't
and
know
Chop
which
Robinson.
One.
Chop
yes,
Robinson.
And Chop Robinson. But I ended up going with Jared Verse, who's regarded and kind of touted as one of the most explosive of the 2024 class. But I think he's a guy that would just his demeanor, the way that he plays, the power, the technique, I think he's a really good fit for Todd Bowles, his penetrating attack style system, but also he has experience lining up inside as well to kind of shoot gaps against the guard, which I think would be great in our complex system because you know Todd Bowles is going to have him doing a variety of things. But well-timed first step. He had 62 pressures in 2023, the fifth most among edge players per PFF. But, man, like hellacious bull rush, the speed-to-power conversion, driving offensive tackles back. I think he's just the guy that kind of fits the bill of what our brass looks for in
yep.
And defensive lineman.
We need more sacks coming from the edge. When Bowles first got here, it's interesting. There have been almost the exact same number of sacks for our defense every single year Bowles has been here. It's just where they're coming from.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
So what I love is it is incredibly impressive. He's been able to manufacture sacks in any way necessary. Mm-hmm. But you know how much easier his life is and the whole defense's life is if they're coming from the edge. And if they're coming from then, you're only maybe rushing four. That's the thing where instead of having to rush as many or send all these other blitzes, he can still do that on top of it. But to have an edge rusher, and Verse had 9 sacks in each of his 2 Florida State seasons. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, give me a guy that is going to consistently get some pressure, get some sacks. And then, man, you're also still sending Antoine. You're also still doing all these other things. But to get more consistency out of that edge position is massive.
Yeah. Could be a 3-down presence.
And we've done pretty well picking Florida State players, so that's all I got
to
say.
Derek and Brooks. He doesn't have to go as far, you know?
I love it, obviously, and it was tough choosing between him and Latu, right?
Mm-hmm.
And maybe even
Chop. Yeah, I struggled.
But I really wish that Brian Thomas had fallen to the Buccaneers. You know why?
Why?
Because we love players whose last name is a very common first name.
That is not the way I saw that going.
Me either.
Levante David, yep. Jamel Dean,
wow.
Servasi Dennis, Randy Gregory, Keenan Isaac.
Wow. Jeez.
Anthony Nelson, J.J. Russell.
Wow. Wow.
Thomas.
Bree's mind is blown right now.
It is right now.
That's and I'm great. Not even counting maybe fringier ones like Rakeem Jarrett or Sean Tucker.
Yeah.
We love those guys.
This is kind of up there with the little donut hole thing.
I don't remember the donut hole thing.
The
donut holes are the holes that are missing out of the center of donuts.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. I did not.
Let's move on.
No. This is gold.
No. I always was under the impression that there was like a template or you made it into a round circle. Mm-hmm. I didn't realize that they made it into essentially a ball and then you punched out the end. I just thought they made it.
Understandable.
Yes. Yeah.
Understandable.
I think that is how they do it.
But I'm like, well, now no wonder in, middle school, high school, they just gave out like ridiculous amount of free bags of donut holes. You just take the donut holes. No, and I'm like, well, this makes sense now.
That's not how they make donut holes.
Yeah, no.
They don't make a solid donut and then punch out the hole.
No.
They do make donuts.
So it is the circle?
They do make donuts as a circle with a hole in the middle, except for like jelly donuts and the ones with custard and stuff in them.
So they do make the donut hole separate.
Yes. Does the donut, the round donut hole look like the middle?
I was right.
We have to move on or Jeff's going to lose his
mind. This kid in high school, man.
All right. Okay. Buffalo, okay. Brandon Bean.
God, no.
We skipped a pick. Arizona.
I'm sidetracked now.
Jeff, you guys.
Jeff, get reengaged here.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I got lost on the donut hole story.
That's why.
Dang, I'm really mad now.
An edge rusher. You can never go wrong.
I love Latu.
Yeah.
I do too.
Latu from UCLA.
Would you just call him LL?
I guess you could.
Cool J.
So the Cardinals walk out of this draft with Marvin Harrison and Latu Latu. And they'll be getting. Yeah. I know we said you can't grade draft picks until 3 years later, but everybody does it anyway.
Mm-hmm.
They'll be walking out with an A on Thursday night.
Yeah, I think so. Yes, I agree.
I also love, this is a funny thing. I'm doing it right now, but when somebody's writing a mock draft and they say, they make a pick and they say, the GM did a great job there to get this. I mean, you're complimenting yourself.
You're the GM right now.
You're like, great job by Monty Osifort to get these two players.
And if you don't pick the picks I made, you are
You're an idiot.
Yeah. All right, on to the next.
Buffalo, Brandon Bean.
Buffalo.
Well, this is an easy one.
Yeah. Wide receiver, Adonai Mitchell from Texas. Yes. Look, obviously the Bills need a wide receiver. Mm-hmm. And
Is that a dig?
Oh, my gosh. I see what you did there. That was good. So this is their biggest roster shakeup since 2019.
Yeah.
And there's only 33 players who were either on their 53-man roster at the end of the year or on in-season injured reserve. So you get rid of, trade away to Stephon Diggs, Gabe Davis left in free agency, like, obviously.
Tre'Davious White.
Yeah, they need.
A lot of guys they lost.
A lot of guys. He won back-to-back national championships with Georgia and transferred to Texas before this season, caught 4 touchdowns in 4 college football playoff games. To me, all of that is like he knows how to play in the big moments, which is something obviously the Bills are wanting to do. That as long as they have Josh Allen, they're thinking that this is a big moment kind of team. And also, I thought this was interesting. I would love to see if they're going to trade up for whatever wide receiver that they want.
They could do that.
I can see that, too, because their GM has traded up 8 times in 6 drafts.
Wow, I did not know this.
4 times in the first round. That's pretty wild.
One of those was with the Bucs.
Yeah.
They traded up for Josh Allen, 12-7.
So I can see where they would do, but either way, I'm like, I feel like they're taking a wide receiver. I just feel like, I don't care where they're picking. Mm-hmm. That feels like what they're going to take. It's just, do they do it at 28? Do they trade up? What's the thought there? But yes, that's our pick.
He's kind of a AD. They also call him AD Mitchell. He's kind of a divisive guy among the scouts because he's obviously got a lot of talent and you cited some numbers there, but overall his production did not really level up to what was expected from his talent. But, you get to the next level, you get in a different situation, and hopefully it works out.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
All right, Detroit, Brad Holmes. Thrilled to see Chop Robinson there. Chop Robinson, probably this edge rusher from Penn State, one of the most athletic guys out there. Mm-hmm. Again, the production maybe didn't blow anybody away, but it's kind of like Javon Walker for the Jaguars a couple of years ago. Some of that was just because of the way he was used and the Lions think they can get more out of him and have a book in for their great other edge rusher.
Right, yeah.
I had to add, I literally wrote this down so I didn't remember, but as we were making this, I said that Dan Campbell would be licking his chops.
She said that.
On this pick, and I didn't even realize that it was a pun when I said it, so I had to add that in.
You got to pretend like you knew. Whenever it's a pun like that, you always got to pretend like
I said no pun intended. How? She's like, I didn't even realize.
I didn't intend. I actually didn't intend it.
Yep.
But yeah.
I'm speechless.
I think I just am amazed at the idea of this pick. Like, as you talk about value pick for positions, you know, we had that whole debate about tight end earlier. Like, to get a potentially elite edge at 29 has got to just make a team thrilled.
Yeah, we were surprised the way this fell out, because a lot of the mocks that I've done myself, there was none of these guys were left when the Bucs picked. So it just the way it happened, but maybe that'll happen.
But yeah, I mean, to pair this guy with Aiden Hutchinson.
I mean, you're going to Detroit right now. What a time to go to Detroit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's
you know, I mean, there's nothing but plus sides there. If they can stay healthy, you know, that's going to be the key for them. But I like the pick. And besides, can you imagine all the marketing things you can do with that name?
With Chop. Do you know where it came from?
No.
He was 11 pounds when he was born, so they nicknamed him Pork Chop.
But Chop sounds better from a football standpoint.
Yeah.
Scott made the point on Insider that if he'd been an offensive lineman, he'd still be Pork Chop.
Yes, I was just going to say.
But Chop is a better edge. It's interesting because I feel like some of the people criticized Aiden Hutchinson before he got drafted for not having the sack numbers you would have thought for someone getting drafted that high. And Chop Robinson also, you know, he only had 4 sacks last year, 5.5 the year prior to that. But if you go by, like, win rate and some other things, that like he's 13th best in all of college football last year. So even though the sack numbers may not be there,
that's a good point.
It feels like a guy that his
can
and that's always what they talk about, that sack numbers can be misleading depending on what all goes on. So yeah, I feel like he's going to be, and again, if he does get paired with Aiden Hutchinson, I feel like that's going to be pretty dangerous.
Well, and he forces quarterbacks to speed up their internal processing with his acceleration and collapsing the pocket, and could potentially create opportunities for one of the other guys on there.
All right. We're near the end here. Baltimore and Eric DaCosta. The Ravens generally seem to just sit where they are and let the players fall to them and take the best one available, and it always seems to work out for them. So who's the next one?
The Ravens go with Tyler Guyton, Oklahoma.
Another tackle.
Yes. It's kind of a freak athlete for a 328-pound man. But he's nimble feet, quick, excellent on lead blocks. He's one of the quickest at the position in the class. Nimble mover, fluid hips, rare first step. So I think his movement skills would be a big upside for the Ravens.
Yeah. 6'7", 328 is, pretty great.
Enough said.
Good profile.
Yep.
Absolute roadblock.
Still some, you know, the scouting report of him is he's a little raw, right?
Right.
But talented and huge.
Yes.
Oh yeah.
Can't coach that.
And quick, yes.
Can't coach that.
Can't coach height.
Yeah.
All right, Jeff, you are John Lynch, and you've got your Hall of Fame jacket on.
Yeah.
So you're 49er polo, but secretly a Bucs t-shirt underneath that.
Yes, always. Forever. Jordan Morgan, Arizona.
Yeah, a tackle. Some people think he might play guard, but that's okay because they have a little bit of a need at both spots. So get him in, like I said before, get him in the building and see where it works best.
And again, an O-lineman, you gotta like it. The other side of the coin is if he's a leader, he'll be known as Captain Morgan.
Okay.
That's already worth it, obviously.
I'll leave
Captain
you with
Morgan
that.
And donut holes, the official meal of the Salty Dogs podcast.
I would eat that.
I would as well.
So I also saw that he's one of only 6 offensive linemen to run the 10-yard split as fast as he did at 310-plus pounds since 1999 at the combine. So
he'd be good on pulling plays and stuff.
So, yeah, I got that quick.
He's pretty fast. His 40-yard was 5'4".
10 matters a lot more than 40 when it comes to a 330-pound lineman.
But his vertical is 28.
Oh, okay.
That's pretty strong.
I don't know if that's good.
His arms are 32, 7/8 his wingspan. That's pretty strong.
I'd have to have comparisons.
Yeah, wouldn't
actually, his wingspan's 81.25.
But sounds good.
Seems big.
Sounds great.
As we continue, last one.
I was here, and this pick was a struggle.
Yes.
It took a long time for this one to get. Like, the clock was ticking, and they had to run up to the podium with the card.
Yeah.
I saw it. So tell us what you...
I saw it, yes.
What did you end up with?
Kansas City wide receiver, Ladd McConkey from Georgia.
Okay.
Yes.
So it's funny. I'm like, I feel like this is a pretty obvious position need for them, particularly when we don't, there's some question Rashee marks Rice around Rashee Rice at the moment. Mm-hmm. And that was just the storyline all year from them, was the wide receivers just having some individual struggles at different times. And so I feel like to have, again, in the first round to be picking last and to have a position of need that happens to be basically the deepest thing in the first round is pretty incredible
right,
for them.
Because the struggle here wasn't, should we take a wide receiver?
Yeah,
it was
what type of receiver do they need to elevate their room?
You considered Xavier Worthy.
Yes.
You considered Keon Coleman. Mm-hmm. You considered
Troy
Xavier
Franklin.
Leggett,
right.
Troy Franklin. And decided this was the one that was the best to round out that.
Well, and it could be a little bit high, but my thing with him that I think was really impressive was just his route running precision.
Yeah.
And I think that the injuries, the back and ankle that he had in 2023 kind of caused him to drop a little bit. But he has, you know, the vertical speed to keep guys honest, but just the way that he devises a plan, almost like a defensive lineman creates like a pass rush plan. Like this guy, you can see the amount of film study that he does and how he attacks corners. Like he has a plan, and just the nuances to his route running. And I think he could end up being a really, really big steal for the Chiefs.
You cool with that?
Yep. I'm good with it.
So we're done. We took 8 offensive tackles, 6 receivers,
jeez,
5 corners, 4 each of quarterback and edge, 2 each of interior defensive linemen and interior offensive linemen, 1 tight end, and no running backs, off-ball linebackers, or safeties. None. 3 positions with no picks, and that's an unusual draft.
That is unusual.
For us, for Jeff and I, my favorite pick was Brian Thomas to the Dolphins. Other than the really obvious ones at the top, what was your favorite pick?
Probably, well, yeah, you said other than the obvious. I mean, Joe Alt for Tennessee, even though that wasn't our pick.
I mean, it's 7 downs.
Yeah,
so.
I feel like that one is the most in terms of the need, the talent, the all of that. I feel like that one was pretty good.
I like J.C. Latham to the Bengals. I think that's great value.
My favorite pick is going to be the one we get right, because
yes,
we might only get one of these right. And
we're getting Caleb Williams
and
right.
I will say this. I am going to mark this sheet.
Yeah,
I'm drafting
Yeah.
Okay. To see how many we got right.
We did.
It'll be fun.
My guess is 5.
I also really liked Chop Robinson to Detroit.
Okay.
Yes.
For
value, I'm going to do Nate Wiggins to Philadelphia as much as
All right. Nice job. Anything else?
No, I think we've done an hour and a half, Jeff. No, you're ready to go.
Actually, not bad. An hour and 16 minutes.
I know
we
you're
did
ready
very,
to go.
Very well. Anybody else got anything?
We learned a lot.
It's a lot faster than the actual draft will happen Thursday night.
Yes.
Yeah, I don't feel too bad about it.
There you go. Very good.
And really, Katy Perry.
Yes.
It's
go
dark
ahead,
horse.
Tell your story.
But I'm coming at you like a dark horse. That's not, she's acting like a dark horse is like some big, strong, mythical beast. Dark horse means like unexpected.
Sneaky, yeah.
The song didn't make any. She just had the phrase she wanted to use.
No, but it makes
sense.
But
didn't use it in a way that makes any sense.
No, that makes sense. You're coming at me like a dark horse. I don't know where you're coming from.
But the rest of the lyrics make it clear that it's like not. It's not coming at you unexpectedly. It's like this, you can't resist me kind of thing.
I'm currently Googling the lyrics because I cannot, off the top of my head, know them.
I need Scott. Have you ever seen the videos of, like, Morgan Freeman where he reads the lyrics of, like, a Justin Bieber song? I need Scott just to read the lyrics of that song.
I would
just
as
with
I'm reading
a very
them, yeah.
straight, like, I need that to happen.
But you better
particularly
choose.
The line that says, make me your Aphrodite. I think I would love
what
to
does
hear
that
Scott.
Have to do with a dark horse?
Yeah. Like,
I'm capable of anything and everything. Don't make me your enemy.
This should be a segment on every single Salty Dogs because this is a salty topic of taking a song that you're just like, this doesn't make
any sense.
I think this should be a new end of show segment for you every time.
My Prerogative by Bobby Brown is another one that we can break down, not right now, that doesn't make any sense. Also, he says prerogative. If you're going to use the word in your song title and say it 20 times, you need to say the word right.
Yeah.
It's prerogative, and he says prerogative the whole time.
I like it.
And how is a dark storm a dark horse a perfect storm? Those aren't the same thing at all.
It's quite contradictory, actually.
Like a bird without a cage?
Means it's free.
We can email Katy Perry for you later.
It's in the palm of
your
hand
thoughts.
Now? None of these lyrics make any sense whatsoever. She just liked the words dark horse and wanted to make a song out of it.
Yeah,
it seems
pretty
like
much.
It worked.
She just thought it'd be catchy, but clearly it was not for Mr.
I kind of like the song, though.
all this and he liked the song.
And since you did, thanks for listening.